Pardon? Thanks. Thank you. And we are at the last of these three meetings dedicated to the green chemistry and different aspects to green chemistry, and organized by the Italian group of the Italian Chemical Society of Green Chemistry. So today we have the great opportunity to hear from Professor Epping, and he will be introduced more in details by our colleague Chiara Samori from Bologna. And I remind everybody that any question can be directly written in the chat of the YouTube page, and so it will be forwarded and represented to Professor Epping. And you can also watch this stream video later on our YouTube web page channel. So thank you again, Professor Epping, for accepting this invitation. I'm sure we will enjoy your contribution to this topic. Please, Chiara, the stage is yours.
Thank you, Luigi. It is a pleasure for me to introduce Professor Epping. Just a couple of words about him. Professor Epping has more than 30 years of experience in downstream processing of large biomolecules, and he developed a lot of biorefinery technologies, such as new purification techniques for proteins, lipids, and carbohydrates extracted from different organisms like microalgae, yeast, and macroalgae. He is a co-author and author of more than 100 scientific papers. And since 2014, he is a special professor at the Department of Bioprocess Engineering at the Wageningen University. Moreover, he is the chair of microalgae bioengineering section of the European Society of Biochemical Engineering Science. And last but not least, he is the senior director of downstream processing at Biondis BV, a biopharmaceutical company that is involved in the purification and the formulation of processes for biopharmaceutical proteins. So it is a really pleasure for me to have you with us, and the floor is yours. And the title of your talk will be Multi-product microalgae biorefineries mediated by ionic lipids.
Oxidized product and the reduced
thank you very
products
much.
From dibutyl sulfide.
Thank you,
they are in the
Chiara.
Same ratio.
Thank
so
you
that
also
means
from the
again,
organization
the reductive principle.
That you allow me to give a talk about the work what we are doing in Wageningen University. So my title will be on multi-product microalgae biorefineries mediated by ionic liquids, but I will also look a little bit to cell desorption technologies. So I'm located in Wageningen by process engineering. Also, my colleague also René Wijfels, who is the head of the department and also well known in the microalgae field. And I will try to give a nice lecture at the seminar Green Chemistry Divisional Group at the Italian Chemistry Society. So I hope you will enjoy. So I will talk a little bit about things what we have done, but also what the some new ideas. What is the idea? Where are we going in this field of the microalgae? So I will give an introduction. I will talk a little bit about cell disruptions, about new ideas, and extraction. I have a couple of topics. And also, I will, in that extraction field, I will handle a few topics, and also including what kind of new technologies are there. And finally, in the conclusions. So I hope I will keep it in mind. So I have about 45 minutes. So first is my introduction. So the potential of the microalgae is for quite some people well known. So because microalgae, they contain carbohydrates, they contain pigments, lipids, and proteins. And it was always known that for microalgae, they could be very interesting for the biofuel part. But to really be competitive in the biofuel market, you need to have very low prices. And that's always a challenge. So therefore, the other products are very important. Like the proteins, you can use it in the food feed products, the carbohydrates as well. And the pigments can be used in the field of cosmetics. And also the lipids you can use not only for the biofuels, but also you can exchange, let's say, certain components, let's say, for oil, which you use also in the food. If you look to the biorefinery of the microalgae, you have mostly a few main parts, main steps, I would say. You have the harvesting. That's a gentle concentration. I will also use a laser pointer. That makes life a little bit easier. Harvesting, so that you have to collect all the cells. Cell disruption is important because you need the components out of the cell. Extraction, you need easy methods to really separate hydrophilic and hydrophobic components, which I will come on later. And then you can perform fractionation for the more high-value products. And important is that you can also, totally, we call it a malt separation process, because you want to get the products as native as possible, which you can use for these high-value markets. That's important, because if you only want to use it for the low-value markets, then you do not need to have the real native state of the products. Okay. This is an overview of the at the Wageningen University, let's say, about the different steps where we have worked on in the harvesting field, in the disruption field, in the extraction and the fractionation. These are all people who have been scientists who have been working on different topics in the four steps. So that we got an idea about how you could easily, the best way to harvest, how you could disrupt the cells, cell disruption, how you could extract the components and fractionate them. This is just a short overview about different research persons who did quite some work in this field. So what the lessons, what we have learned, is that we want to go from a batch to a continuous integrated processing. Because batch processing is can be quite expensive. And if you could develop a biorefinery approach in a more continuous integrated processing, that could lower the costs. You reduce the number of auxiliaries that are added to the process streams, because for harvesting, you could use flocculants, but then you, let's say, you add chemicals to it, and you want to prevent that as well, that you want to do that as low as possible. Minimize the amount of processing required, because the reason is also that that less processing also will lower the cost of the process steps. And functionality is more important. So that's really important that you get really good functionalities of your product. And another challenge is the disentanglement and subsequently the extraction of the insoluble molecules. Because you have products like lipids, but also hydrophobic proteins or polysaccharides, which are not easily to separate, especially when components are located in the cell wall. So that makes it difficult. So I will focus on two parts of this biorefinery approach. That's looking more to the cell disruption and to the extraction. Those two main parts I will discuss. First is the cell disruption. So the cell disruption is one of the main, I would say, maybe the most important step in our process, where you want to destroy the cells in the way that you get the different products, the carbohydrates, the proteins, the lipids, and the pigments. Now, the idea is also what we are looking at from the Wageningen perspective. We have to look to new cell disruption technologies, radically new kind of methods, which should be economical viable, which could lead to economical viable algae ingredients. So if you look to the cell disruption now, you see here a cell with the different organelles in the cell. And here you see some protein structures, some organelles and a nucleus and the chloroplast here. And if you use now techniques like bead milling, so mechanical or chemical techniques, you destroy the cells and you get a mixture of components and the energy consumption, especially when you use bead milling techniques, is very high. And you release ultrafine particles that cannot be separated, but you get, let's say, you can get a mixture of lipids, proteins, carbohydrates, which can be make kind of emulsions, and these could be more difficult to release. Like that's also a problem, because the proteins and the lipids could form together, so the proteins can be unfolded, and then they found they make a mixture with lipids and some polysaccharides, so it's difficult to separate the components. So the next generation of disruption, so you can look to some ideas, is about one idea is the enzyme cocktails, where you can use enzymes from fungi, or you could look to other triggers. I will come to that. And algae proteins might be degraded. Most polysaccharides are hydrolyzed. How to stop these enzymes and no fines are produced? Because if you want to use enzymes, they can continue and degrade your products. That's not what you want. So you have to look to ideas, how could we do that? So in a way that you disrupt the cells, but that you keep your components intact. So this is an idea. So you have marine fungi, they can express different enzymes. And when you give them different, especially when you give them different substrates of algae. So we have here a couple of gels, so you do not have to look to all the details, but if you look to the first slide here, substrates of algae. First lane is a marker. These are marker proteins. And then you have three organisms, which wheat bran, Nanochloropsis is an microalgae, and Tetracellinis. So what you do, you give the fungi, you give them or wheat bran, or you give them Nanochloropsis, or you give them Tetracellinis. So you give them the microalgae as kind of a substrate, which the fungi can eat. So what they do, the fungi, they express certain enzymes, like those thick bands, which you can see over here and here. The reason is what they do, they eat the microalgae, and that's why they have to make new enzymes where they can break the cell walls of the microalgae. So in that way, you could adapt the fungi in a way that they could eat the microalgae, and that they make those enzymes, and you can isolate those enzymes so that those enzymes are very specific for microalgae degradation. So you can make very specific cell disruption techniques. So the idea is that you have to quantify the impact of the skisser on the cell, the algae cell strength. So you have to know if you use these enzymes, how strong are these microalgae cell walls still? Are they completely destroyed or only holes, or are they not affected? So with atomic force microscopy, you can look to the strengths, let's say, of the algae cell wall. So, and these future cell disruption, you can break them. What is the easiest way? You can do it with enzymes from the outside, what we discussed. So you use enzymes, let's say, from fungi, that they break the cell wall, and then you can collect the components. Or you can use autolysis, so triggered by other factors, which can help, which can be done as well, so that the algae cells are trained in such a way that if you trigger them with a certain kind of a light pulse or whatever, that you get a kind of autolysis and that the cell wall is broken down. So these are new ideas. So you have the microalgae species in this example, some autolysis examples, and the cell that induces can be UV radiation, darkness with oxidative stress, darkness, environmental stress, heat stress, or salt stress. So these are all methods in which you could really degrade the cells, and in a way where you can collect your components. So, and there you have some markers which you can really investigate if the cells are being degraded. So this is a very nice approach, and I will show you one example of the darkness here. So the examples are scarce, as the mechanisms is unknown, but understand the cell suicide pathway and how can we trigger them? So we have here the light. This is a microalgae. It uses CO2. It goes into the dark. And then you get a kind of a programmed cell death. That means, and the components come free, and then you, let's say you have some algae still left over, and they can grow, and under light, they can multiply again. But during the dark, you get a kind of a programmed cell death, and then is the question, how does this happen? So this is one of the references, Aurel Lana in 2013, did quite some work in this field as well. So that you look to easy techniques where you can break the cell walls of those microalgae and not using techniques which you have to use a lot of energy. So the processing issues, so when you have the microalgae, so the current are the dried processing, requiring drying, and fossil-based solvents and chemicals used. Future, let's say when we go more to the wet processing, the drawback is of course strong emulsions formed and very stable suspensions. So you have to look how you could prevent it. And I will give you another example. Another idea is also to use a kind of different kinds of fields. That means you can do that based on you have to disentangle membrane proteins and polar lipids, fractionate the different polysaccharides, and fractionate soluble proteins and carbohydrates. So you can use different external fields, gravity, electric field, laser technology, magnetic field, ultrasonic waves, and laminar asymmetry flow, all different kinds of external fields you could use to separate your products in this way. And I will show you one example. Here you got the algae in this external field. You have here the algae cells located here. Then you do a kind of a harvesting. So you put kind of pulses, electric pulses or magnetic pulses, so that the microalgae cells clock together. So they form larger aggregates and they will sediment here. And the rest of the algae, which are still in ferment or in solution, you can feed them back to the bioreactor. But these cells, which are clumped together, you can perform a kind of a disruption with another external field that can be acoustics, can be electric, and then you can separate the products. And those products here, you can also break these smaller particles with another fractionation method that can be again another external field, like pulsed electric field or whatever, that you can separate the products in these disrupted algae cells. So then you can fractionate your components. You have here the polysaccharides, you have here the proteins, and you have here the lipids. And if you can do this in a continuous mode operation, then you can make a very nice algae cell a processing of the microalgae in a way that you could really separate nicely your products. So this is just an example how you could do that. Now, this is cell disruption, an idea how you could do that. And now we go to the main topic, that's the extraction. So that means the biorefinery of the microalgae again. And then we go to extraction. So we have here the harvesting, you collect the microalgae, the cell disruption. We talked a little bit already about it in the former slides, how you could disrupt the cells. And then we have extraction, we will discuss now. And later on, you can also perform, if needed, a very high value fractionation, that you can separate the different, let's say, proteins or different polysaccharides. But the main topic is perform to do a kind of a mass separation process. So extraction is a simple approach. You have two phases. You have, let's say here, a solvent phase and a water phase, and it contains citric acid. You mix, and then certain amount of the citric acid goes to the top phase and some go to the bottom phase. And in this way, you can calculate the distribution coefficient. And you can do the same for lipids, for proteins, for polysaccharides, and whatever. And this way, you could calculate how much is going into a solvent and into a water phase. So this is the simple principle for extraction. What we will do with the algae, it's in different ways. So we have the algae extract that can be disrupted, or it can be a complete algae cells, because some extractant, some components are able to really destroy the algae cell. You can do that with polymers, like a polyethylene glycol, or you can do it with anic liquids. I will discuss both of them. So you can do a separation of the components in the hydrophobic components, like the lipids and the pigments, and the hydrophilic components, the proteins and the carbohydrates. You can do a phase separation. And even you could do a further fractionation by obtaining functional stable hydrophobic components and obtaining functional stable hydrophilic components. So this is kind of a further processing. But we will focus mostly here on the first separation of the hydrophilic and the hydrophobic components. If you do that in an aqueous two-phase extraction, you have normally two phases here. You have a top phase here, that's a little bit of green, or let's say yellow color, and you have a bottom phase, which has a clear color, so not really a color, like it looks like water. And in the top phase, you can do the hydrophobic components, and in the bottom phase, the hydrophilic components, because this is a hydrophobic phase and a hydrophilic phase. And you can use polymers, like PEG, polyethylene glycol, dextran, whatever, or PPG. You can use a polymer salt phase. You can use a surfactant or a surfactant polymer. That depends on the components which you want to extract. Mostly what you see is the polymer salt, let's say, separation. So that the polymer is in the top phase and the salt is in the bottom phase. And the components divide between those two phases. Now, it looks that this is a very complicated slide, but I will show you step by step what's going on. So here we do the bead milling. So we have the microalgae. We do the bead milling. Bead milling means that we mix the algae cells with zirconium beads in such a way that the algae cells will be destroyed and that the components of the microalgae come free. So you get you mix them together with PPG 400, that's a polymer, and gadolinium, that's a buffer component, and gadolinium dehydroxyphosphate. And then you get three phases. You have a top phase, you have an interphase, and you have a bottom phase. In the bottom phase, what we see is mostly sugars and proteins. And in the top phase, mostly you see pigments. You see some small amount of sugars and proteins. And you have an interphase, and the interphase contains pigments, starch, lipids, proteins, and free sugars. So the top phase you separate, and the bottom phase you separate, and with the interphase you go to the next extraction phase. So then you add again PPG 400, and then you get again in the top phase pigments, some soluble sugars, and a few amount of proteins. And in the bottom phase, mainly soluble sugars and proteins. And in the interphase, you see the pigments, the starch, and the lipids, and also some proteins. And you, this interphase you take, and you go to the third step. Again, you add PPG 400, and that means that in again, you get a separation between through a top phase, a bottom phase, and an interphase. The interphase contains mainly starch and lipids, and the top phases here, you collect them all together here, yeah, from the first, the second, and third, you mainly have about 90-80% of the pigments. So mainly the pigments go to the top phase, and the bottom phase here, mostly what you see is proteins, 82%, and soluble sugars. They are in mostly located here in the bottom phase. So this is a three-step approach of an aqueous two-phase extraction with PPG. It's more or less a similar kind of polymer as like PEG. And then you can really perform a nice separation, let's say, of disrupted microalgae. So you separate them into the pigments, starch and lipids, because starch is more a solid part. And you have the lipids, and you have here the proteins and the soluble sugars, like glucose, which you have. So this is a nice way of separating the molecules. Now we go on to the next step. So we have the polymers, but also we have anic liquids. This one, anic liquids. If you compare those anic liquids with organic solvents, the amount of possibilities is very high. They have multifunctional. They are they have a catalytic ability and chirality. They are non-flammable. They have a strong sulfation. The costs are higher when you compare it with organic solvents. And the viscosity is higher. You have a certain density, refractive index, and vapor pressure for organic solvents, yes, but not for ionic liquids. Now, what are those ionic liquids? As asymmetrical salts are liquids below 100 degrees and composed of anions and cations. So these are the cations, like imidazolium, pyridinium, pyrolidinium, phosphonium, ammonium, sulfonium, or you have the anion. That can be different components as well. As you can see, they can be strong negative and they are more positive. The advantage of these ionic liquids, they are thermally stable. They have very low vapor pressure and you have a large variety available. I showed in the last slide. So here you can ionic solid crystalline lead ice at 803. And this is the quaternary ammonium chloride. This it's a non-crystalline lead ice. And then they have a much lower, melting point. So normally you work with ionic liquids are salts, but then in solution. So when you have sodium chloride, it's also a salt, but it is solid. So, and we work with ionic liquids are salts, but then they are in a liquid solution, normally at room temperature. So there are some nice review articles where a lot of this is present about ionic liquids. One of the questions you always get, yeah, but they are toxic. So here is an overview about ionic liquids. That can be gadolinium, phosphonium, imidazolium, guanidinium, pyrolidinium, pyridinium, morpholium, based ionic liquids. And they can be toxic, like shown over here, or they can harmless or practically harmless. So that means here imidazolium can be harmless and also the gadolinium can be harmless. In a way that whether they are toxic or not, that's always the question what you get. So we have written an article this year, a review article about ionic liquids 2021 in Trends in Tips. And there you can have a show an overview about the use of ionic liquids. It's a very powerful molecule because they can form an aqueous to phase system. So you have here a cell extract that contains proteins, and here you add, let's say, the ionic liquid. You mix the solution in the tube and you get the phase separation. And the upper phase is the ionic liquid enriched phase and the bottom phase is more the salt rich phase. And you can separate those two phases and then you can back extract ionic liquid also. So it's not one-time use, but you can reuse it if you extract the ionic liquid from the solution. So this is an idea about an aqueous phase system with ionic liquids. So this is again over here, you have a cell extract. You mix, let's say, with an ionic liquid here, you get a phase separation, you have ionic liquid rich phase and you have the salt rich phase. Now, and it can be done with an imidazolium based ionic liquid, IELI-2-1, so they normally have coats. But you have to keep in mind, you can separate different proteins like a BSA or an IgG molecule, but also a Rubisco. Rubisco is a protein, it's dominant available in microalgae, but it's a multi-complex molecule. It has 8 small subunits and 8 large subunits. So it makes it also very sensitive, because if the amount, the concentration of ionic liquid is too high, then this protein will denature. Whereas these molecules, BSA and IgG, are much more stable molecules because they are covalently linked to each other and very strong. Whereas for Rubisco, the large subunits and the small subunits are non-covalent interacting with each other. So, and they can denature. I will show you that later. So in this one, here you get the protein extraction and stability. How stable are the proteins in these ionic liquids? So that is, we did quite some work on a liquid-based extraction of Rubisco. As Rubisco is, of course, a ribulose bifosphate, oxygenase, decarboxylase is a well-known protein. And it's an important protein because it captures the CO2 from the air in the algae, but also in plants. And then it uses its CO2 into energy for the plant or for a microalgae. So partition coefficient of Rubisco and liquids-based systems is much higher than compared with polyethylene glycol systems with the standard polymers. So you can do a very nice extraction of Rubisco with ionic liquids in microalgae. And then you need a certain concentration of ionic liquid and phosphate concentration to separate it. But keep in mind what we have seen, because Rubisco is an enzyme. And if all the large and small subunits are together, it's active. So then it's also able to convert CO2. But if the concentration of Rubisco is increasing, let's say from 10% to 20%, 30%, then the activity of Rubisco goes down. What is the reason? The ionic liquids are charged and they could interact with Rubisco under high concentrations, and they are able then to block the activity of this Rubisco and also unfold the protein. And I will show you that in one of the next slides. So you can do a very nice extraction, but if the concentration of ionic liquids are too high, then it's really a problem. So this is also what we show in this slide. You have here a BSA. It's a single subunit molecule, protein molecule. IgG is a multiple subunit covalently coupled to each other. And the Rubisco is also multiple subunits, but the subunits of the protein are non-covalently interacting with each other. So extraction and liquid-based aqueous to phase extraction, it gives very good partitioning, good separation. Stability of the proteins and liquids is protein dependent, because if the concentration of ionic liquids is too high, the protein may unfold, and that happens also with the Rubisco. With BSA and IgG also, but only at very high ionic liquid concentrations. When you want to separate it at 60 to 80% of ionic liquids, then you also get a kind that your protein will unfold. And if it's unfolded, you cannot use it anymore for as a high value product in the food industry or whatever. So you have to be careful using these molecules. Now, you also can perform a lipid and a pigment extraction. So we discussed the protein, now we go to the pigment and the lipids. So here we have the intact microalgae, what we do, and it contains lipids, pigments, carbohydrates, and also proteins. So you can do extraction with ionic liquids and solvents. So what you do, you have an intact microalgae, but you make small pores. Those ionic liquids are able to make small pores so that lipids and pigments are excreted out of the cell, and the microalgae remains intact. So that was a very interesting investigation experiment, what we discovered, that we could keep the molecule intact, but that the lipids and the pigments are excreted. And then you can do the cell disruption by, let's say, bead milling, and then you can collect the proteins and the carbohydrates. So first, you extract the hydrophobic components with the ionic liquids. And then after cell disruption, then you can disrupt the cells and you can extract the hydrophilic components, such as the polysaccharides and the proteins. So I will show you a nice example. This is Haematicoccus pluvialis, Neochloris, and Neochloris oleabundans. These are two microalgae. This is Haematicoccus. It contains high amounts of astaxanthin. So you see also the red-orange color. Very nice. That's the astaxanthin. It contains also carbohydrates, proteins, and lipids. It's a rigid cell wall, and it's about 20 micrometers size in diameter. Then we have the Neochloris oleabundans. It is a greenish cell. It contains high amounts of lipids, rich source of protein carbohydrates, a rigid shovel, but much smaller, 3 to 5 micrometers. And you see, here is not astaxanthin present, but more chlorophyll. Chlorophyll has a green color. You can see that in this Neochloris oleoabundans. What you do with the astaxanthin extraction from Haematococcus pluvialis, because what you want to get the astaxanthin out of these cells. But how can you do that? Now, you have the cells with, and you incubate them with anaerobic liquids. And then you remove the excess of anaerobic liquids, and then you incubate the cells, which still contain some anaerobic liquids on the cell wall, and you incubate them with ethyl acetate. And what happens? The cells extract the astaxanthin, which is in the cell, is extracted. So you can separate the ethyl acetate with the astaxanthin. So you keep the cells, let's say, which have less or almost no astaxanthin, and you extract them with ethyl acetate out of the cells. So the anaerobic liquids, what they do is they interact with the cell wall, they make small pores, and then ethyl acetate is able to extract then the hydrophobic components. And then what you could do with the cells which do not contain any astaxanthin anymore, you could disrupt them and get the proteins and the carbohydrates, so the hydrophilic components. So first you extract the hydrophobic components, keep the cells intact, only small pores in the cell wall, and then you can perform the cell disruption and extract the hydrophilic components. Now, we use different anaerobic liquids, but most what we have seen is we used kind of phosphonium-based anaerobic liquids or imidazolium-based anaerobic liquids and ethyl acetate. So if you do only incubation of ethyl acetate with the algae cells, nothing happens. But if you incubate them with imidazolium-based anaerobic liquids, like over here, this one and this one, then they can extract more than 70%, close to 80% of astaxanthin, because the anaerobic liquid interacts with the cell wall, and then you incubate after that with ethyl acetate, and then you can extract a lot of it from the from astaxanthin. But if you only use ethyl acetate, it's not possible, because ethyl acetate is not able make small holes or pores in the cell. So this was a very interesting investigation. I show you over here, you have the cells with acetone, nothing happens. You have the cells with ethyl acetate at 65 degrees, nothing happens, they keep the color. But if you have the cells and incubate them with the imidazolium anaerobic liquid, so they make pores, then you can extract them by using then as ethyl acetate as the second component. And then they are colorless. So this was a very nice experiment and investigation to keep the cells more or less intact. You have some small pores in the cells, but that you can extract astaxanthin from it. And you can see that, or you cannot really see that with the scanning electron microscopy. So we thought if we do interactions, then we could see the small holes, but it's impossible. These are the Haematococcus pluvialis cells. After treatment with ethyl acetate, you get a kind of, they are a little bit shrinked. After treatment with anaerobic liquids, you see a kind of a film around the Haematococcus cells. And after treatment with anaerobic liquid plus ethyl acetate, you see is a kind of a film around the cells. And below this film, in the cell wall, there should be some pores available where the astaxanthin can be extracted. It was not possible to see that under the scanning electron microscopy, because the anaerobic liquid makes kind of a film around the cell. Now, you can also perform some concentration studies. So you have the anaerobic liquid, PMIM and EMIM. So these are imidazolium-like anaerobic liquids. And then you incubate them with increasing concentration of ethyl acetate. So if you need about 40% ethyl acetate, then you can already extract most of the astaxanthin. So lower amounts of ethyl acetate are not possible, but higher it's better. But if you go too high, it's possible that with one anion liquid, the extraction goes down of the SSNT. And you can also look to the percentage of anion liquid. Do I need 100%, 20%, 40%? So if I need 80% of anion liquid, what you can see here, over here, there's more than 60% of the SSNT goes into the ethyl acetate, whereas still quite some astaxanthin remains an ionic liquid. But if you use a 40% ionic liquid, you see that almost all the ethyl acetate takes up, let's say, the astaxanthin pigments. So that means you incubate the cells with 40% ionic liquid, then you add the ethyl acetate, and then the ethyl acetate takes up the astaxanthin. So the anion liquid is needed to make small holes in the cell wall, which the ethyl acetate cannot do. And in the second step, the ethyl acetate is able to extract the astaxanthin from the pores of the cell wall. That was with pigments, but we can see the same kind of approach also for lipid extraction. So there we use the Neochlorus oleabundans. So that's more the microalgae, which only contains the pigments. So what we see with the approach, fresh and freeze-dried Neochlorus oleabundans, you can extract from intact cells. So here you have the, let's say, the microalgae. You have the green colors. These are that's your lipids. You do the pretreatment with anion liquid. You separate the ionic liquids, the overloaded, and the ionic liquid still present on the cell wall. You incubate together with chloroform, methanol, or ethyl acetate, and you extract, let's say, the lipids, so that only no more lipids are present in the Neochlorus oleabundans cells. So that's a very nice approach. And then you can disrupt the cells and get the proteins, the carbohydrates. So with the lipids, if you look to the, we can do that with fresh cells and frozen cells. So the fresh cells and frozen cells, the amount of fatty acids can be extracted. And we can also, so before cell disruption, you can extract the lipids. And that you can do that with chloroform methanol, and you use also with the 40 this ionic liquid, 40% TBP SO4, that's a phosphonium-based ionic liquid. And what you see is that you can extract already so total fatty acids from it. And after the cell disruption, you can only, let's say, extract then the proteins. So the lipids you extract out of complete intact cells, and then the proteins after the cell disruption. So, and then what interesting is, if you do the cell disruption and then you look to the proteins, you can look to Rubisco. Rubisco is the large molecule, protein molecule, and with a native SDS page, you can see whether the Rubisco is intact. So in this way, you can also, let's say, extract further the lipids out of the contact, out of the cells which are still intact. Then you destroy the cells, and then you get the proteins. And then you see that you can get the Rubisco, who is in a native state, because it's also, it has about a molecular size about 500 kilodalton, and it's still intact. So that is a very nice approach. So the now one step more, I will talk about the microgel particles. So there you have the intact microalgae. You do the cell disruption or bead milling. So you disrupt the microalgae. Then you can extract the proteins, the carbohydrates, hydrophilic phase, and anionic liquids of the hydrophobic phase. That means the lipids and the pigments. So, and you can use the anionic liquids plus the microgels to separate those phases. So what we do, we have microgel particles, particles formed by polymerization of NIPAM, polynipam, and methacrylamide, and cross-linked with methylene bisacrylamide. So you get a kind of microgel particles. These microgel particles stabilize the ion water, the ionic liquid water interface. So what you will see, you have here the microgel particles with the ionic liquids. You have the bead mill cell suspension. You mix them together, you get a kind of a mass. So it looks like a really a mass. But it in one phase contains the proteins and the other phase contains the pigments because we use the hematococcus. And what we see over here, these are the microgel particles. The aniglyquids, they contain the astaxanthin, and the protein is in the aqueous phase. So that's not in the microgel particles. So what you see over here, that the microgel particles, they contain the astaxanthin, the iodoprots, and the protein is in the other phase. So the aqueous phase ionic liquid droplets containing the proteins and astaxanthin respectively. So the aqueous phase, the proteins, and ionic liquid phase contains the astaxanthin because proteins are hydrophilic and the astaxanthin is hydrophobic. So that remains in these microgel particles. So we can also look to the protein stability. The top, the aqueous phase contains the Rubisco. And still we see that in the top phase, which contains the proteins, the Rubisco is still in a native conformation. So it has about a size of 500 kilodalton. So it's not dissociating or inactivated, but it's still active. So that you get directly separation with these microgel particles. And the simple procedure is you have the ionic liquid solution. You have a cell suspension with them plus the microgel particles also. You mix them together. You get an aqueous solution of proteins and an ionic liquid solution plus the microgel particles with the astaxanthin. And then you can, let's say, take the top phase and you can separate the two phases if you want. So this is in a way how you could perform separations of your components. So one thing I would like to mention in my last few slides is other solvents. So we can use organic solvents, existing technology, toxic protein denaturation and regeneration by distillation. Ionic liquids, they're tunable, they're non-volatile, mostly fossil-based, expensive, and most of them are toxic. And we have the deep eutectic solvents. One is they're tunable, non-volatile, renewable, bio-based, easy preparation, biodegradable, and food grade and cheap. So this is the new area since the last year that people are focusing on. Deep eutectic solvents, what is it? You have a choline chloride component, urea, and you mix them together, and then you see that they got changed in the melting points. Because choline chloride, urea 1 to 2, has due to this deep eutectic solvent, they have a lower kind of a melting point. So they go from, let's say, from 575, 275 Fahrenheit up to 556, so 12 degrees. So they have a melting point at 302 and 133 as separate components. But if you mix them together, then the melting point goes to 12 degrees. So that's why it's called, they lowered the deep eutectic solvent. So the melting point is lowered. And there are different combinations possible in these deep eutectic solvents. Combinations which can be used to form a very nice deep eutectic solvent, which are biodegradable. So we are working still on it. So on this in this field by deep eutectic solvent activities, extraction and back extraction of screening for DES molecules. We look to the solubility. Then we do a microalgae extraction. So we found interesting DES molecules to extract, let's say, components. And we want to understand the physiological properties as well of these molecules, viscosity, the stability, and so on. And also the extraction systems. Can we do it in develop a system where we can really, let's say, extract the different microalgae components like the proteins, the carbohydrates, and the lipids, and the pigments with these deep eutectic solvent molecules? Can we perform a scale-up and technical economic analysis? So this is an activity what we are still working on in Wageningen. And also I know that one important person also in Italy, from Marco Bravi, is also working in this field on deep eutectic solvents. Also published recently an article just like we did as well. So overall, in the conclusions, proteins are stable ionic liquids at low concentration, no dissociation of subunits in large protein complexes like Rubisco. At high concentrations they do. Imidazolium ionic liquids have the capability to permeabilize hematococcus pluvialis cells needed for extraction of astaxanthin. And imidazolium aniliquids with longer chain lengths are suitable for permeabilizing algae cells to extract the lipids. So dependent on the aniliquid, you can extract as well lipids from intact cells. Functional protein recovery aniliquids after aniliquid and ethylacetate incubated cells is feasible. So you can recover the proteins after you incubate aniliquid, the cells with aniliquid and ethylacetate, you extract the pigments and or the lipids, then you can, destroy the cells and you can recover the proteins. Emulsion of aniliquids in water-stabilized particles serves then you can for the separation of hydrophobic and from hydrophobic components after cell disruption. And the future will focus more on the biodegradable molecules like the deep eutectic solvents, because they are very degradable and very well used and becoming more popular. So with that, I would end my talk about, and I think I've more about 45 minutes talked about it, and hope, are there any questions?
Thank you very much, Michael.
Was it in time?
Yes, for sure.
Okay.
So we can start the question, part.
Yep.
Please, Antonella.
Thanks, Chiara. And thank for your interesting presentation. In my opinion, the use of ionic liquid is very interesting, and also the use of deep eutectic solvent.
Yeah.
However, my question is, in your opinion, is it possible to foresee greater development in the industrial level for this kind of solvent? Or we have disadvantage in the use respect to the traditional organic solvent on water phase? What is the situation today in order to develop to the industrial production for in the use of the ionic liquid solvent?
Now microphone. So can you repeat shortly the question again?
Yes. The use of the ionic liquid is very interesting.
Yeah.
But my question is, today, regarding the use in the industrial production,
very not
is
good
possible
question.
To foresee greater development of the use of the...
Yeah, good question. I know there are only a few things where they are being used in industrial production already, more in the chemical industry as well. And I know that one of the big companies is now developing a new factory for making a few specific ionic liquids also at large scale. So yes, they are busy to get molecules more for industrial production, but it takes time, because if the production is not large, then the costs, of course, are too high in relation to, let's say, organic solvents. Yeah, but that's a good question. If you need more applications, then they will perform more and more interesting to do to develop more, increasing the size or the scale up, let's say, scale up the production of ionic liquids. Yes, but I've seen recently that one of the big companies, I think it was Basf or was it Bayer, whatever, they started to produce a large scale ionic liquid production. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Michael. I have a couple of questions while we are waiting if there are questions from YouTube. The first question is about the pores, the small pores that specific ionic liquids are able to create on the surface
yeah.
of algae. Is it possible that these pores are not detrimental for algae survival? I mean, is it possible to induce the creation of small holes that keep algae alive?
Yeah.
and able to produce again for example, Lipitor?
Yeah, that's a good question, and I think they can, so that you create some pores, so that you get some products out, and that you can grow them further. That is possible. Yes, okay. I did only very little work on it, but it's possible to do that. Yes, yeah.
And my second question is about you say that the stability of proteins in ionic liquids is protein dependent.
Yeah.
So maybe this can be a reason for which in biocatalytic reaction or in biocatalysis in ionic liquids some enzymes do not work and other,
In enzymes, in biocatalytic reactions, sometimes what you see is there, they stabilize, let's say, certain enzymes and so on for the reaction. But we use them, of course, to separate the products, but if you make the concentrations too high, they might interact on the active sites and so on, and they could block activity, or they also could unfold proteins, because normally you use the import charged molecules like fluorine and bromine, so they are very active, but they can also be used as stabilization in biocatalysis. That was, I think, one of the earliest ideas to work with ionic liquids. Yes.
Okay, thank you. And I think I will have time for the last question and then I will stop myself. When you spoke about microgel particles used for astaxanthin extraction, microgel particles.
How big they are, do you mean that?
I mean, you show an example of use of microgel particles plus ionic liquids plus astaxanthin. Yeah. Is it possible to use this formulation for some application? I mean, without separating the ionic liquids from the microgel particles and astaxanthin? If you use, for example, biocompatible...
Now what we did is, you can, we try to use it also in a continuous mode operation. So what we did, we took the disrupted microalgae, and what we did is then the astaxanthin is then extracted in the microgel particles in the ionic liquids, and then the protein is in the aqueous phase. So we could continuously remove the top phase up to a certain moment that the microgel particles with the ionic liquids are saturated with astaxanthin. So, and then you have to regenerate them again. You can do that. So you can take out the microgel particles with the ionic liquids. And what you then do is you just change the temperature, because the microgel particles, they have... and you go to 35 degrees, they become the particles then become unfold, let's say, I would say. So you can deform the microgel particles, and then you can extract the astaxanthin, and then you can form the microgel particles again by changing the temperature, and then you can reuse them again. So that can be an example used for the other applications as possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very interesting. So I don't know if there are any other questions from the web. I will just let a second. Okay, so I think there are no questions from YouTube. Luigi, are you here? Luigi?
Sure, of course, but okay. Yes, I expected you gave the chair to Antonella. And that's why.
Yes, okay, Michael. Perfect. So I would like to thank you, Michael, so much for your presentation. Yeah. It was very, very interesting.
Thank you. Actually, I wanted to ask one curiosity about, if still having time, because in your lecture, you basically were kind of positive. The message was very positive for ionic liquids and deep eutectic solvents. This is for the specific application, or you may translate this positive message also to other application more in general for these type of solvents.
Yeah, I think so. For you can use these kind of emulsions also in the oil industry. So there you they use a lot of emulsions that you can use these molecules as well. The main thing is that you have to reuse them. If you do not reuse them, then the costs can be quite high. So that's always an important thing, that you have to have a good back extraction of it.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, especially for the final focus, because the reuse of such a material is key. Is a key essential point, and so that's the focus. I much appreciate the focus on this. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Okay. So I think that we can pass to the second section of the day. If you would like to stay here for the short presentation about the deeper tactic solvents, so maybe is a topic that is quite related to your talk.
Yeah, no, it's very nice, eh? that was a good introduction for the next talk. Yes.
Thank you very much. Yeah. And I think Luigi.
I think I will introduce Martina.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. And, thank you.
Thank again, Michael, for the presentation. And so this is time for the lecture, for the contribution given by Martina Vagnoni. Please, Martina, can you share the presentation?
Yes, of course. Okay.
Okay, that's fine. So you can put in presentation mode, and so the contribution will be on the extraction of astaxanthin, and of course using hydrophobic deep eutectic solvents. So the contribution is from the Alma Mater Bologna, the group from Chiara Samori and Paola Galletti. Martina, I feel you should share the entire screen, as I don't see you in presentation mode.
Okay, can you see my screen in presentation mode now?
No. Please push the presentation mode more
firmly. Yeah. I made it. Yes.
Okay,
can you see it now?
You should share the entire desktop instead of the single app.
Yeah. No. I tried again, even if I've already made this. Okay. I can try again. Okay. Sorry. Sorry, I have some problems.
No, you go now. You go out on the PowerPoint. That will be fine.
Yeah. I know. It's the problem is that I've closed the PowerPoint. Okay.
I can see.
Okay, sorry. Okay. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, fine.
And now do you see presentation mode? Okay. Okay, sorry. Okay, can I start? Okay. So first of all, I'd like to thank the committee for giving me the opportunity to present this work about the extraction of astaxanthin from Haematococcus pluvialis with hydrophobic deep eutectic solvents. And Haematococcus pluvialis is a green macroalgae whose life cycles consist of two steps, as well described by Professor Epping, the green motile phase and the red non-motile phase. The passage to the second phase is obtained putting the culture under stressful conditions, like high light irradiance and nitrogen starvation. The red color of this second phase is due to the presence and accumulation of a ketocarotenoid called Astaxanthin. Haematococcus pluvialis has a great relevance in the production of astaxanthin, which is considered the most powerful carotenoid antioxidant. The production and extraction of natural astaxanthin has also an economic value, since the synthetic astaxanthin is not approved for direct human consumption and so cannot be used in food industry. Moreover, natural astaxanthin proved to have a higher antioxidant activity respect to the synthetic one. And these differences in the bioactivity is due to intrinsic characteristics of the two molecules. In fact, the natural astaxanthin is accumulated and biosynthesized in lipid vesicles composed by triacylglycerols, and it is extracted together with the triacylglycerols which compose these vesicles. It is also extracted together with other bioactive carotenoids like beta-carotene, cantaxanthin, and lutein. But first of all, it is in the red phase of Haematococcus pluvialis, it is in a mono or disterified form with various kinds of fatty acids, while the synthetic form of astaxanthin has the two hydroxyl groups in the free form. And a selective mono or deesterification with fatty acids is pretty difficult to obtain. Also, from a stereochemical point of view, there are some differences with proved to be crucial to determine differences in the antioxidant activity of the two species. So, after the cultivation step and the production and accumulation of astaxanthin, there is the harvesting of the culture, then the centrifugation to remove the aqueous phase, and then the freeze drying of the biomass. So the lyophilized biomass can be subjected to the extraction of astaxanthin. Among the non-conventional methods, there is the use of organic solvents used with various pre-treatments. And among the most recent methods, one of the most used is the supercritical carbon dioxide. Also, the ionic liquid, as well presented by Professor Epping, very interesting applications. And in recent years, deep eutectic solvents are gaining much attention. The deep eutectic solvents used in this work can be considered hydrophobic since they are immiscible with water. The solvents we used are composed by two compounds, and one of them is always oleic acid, while the other one is always a bio-based compound. We will call DAMO with some acronyms. So the MAO is composed by menthol and oleic acid, the GAO by geraniol and oleic acid, the PAO by phosphatidylcholine and oleic acid, and the TAO by thymol and oleic acid. The most important feature of this solvent is that they are non-volatile. So the extract cannot be separated from the solvent after the extraction process. This means that for future application, the solvent must be not only safe, but should be able to maintain or enhance the bioactivity of the bioactive compound extracted. So we tested all the solvents, extracting astaxanthin from the freeze-dried biomass, putting them in comparison with a mixture of classical organic solvents that we will call CAE, composed by cyclohexane, acetone, and ethanol. And we observed that the recovery ability of all these solvents can be considered comparable. And the amount of astaxanthin recovered that you see in the graph is expressed as a percentage of astaxanthin respect to the biomass, and the data are comparable with that found in literature. As I said before, astaxanthin is not isolated in the free form and as only one molecule, but in a monoesterified or deesterified form together with other carotenoids. So lutein, cantaxanthin, and beta-carotene. And we put in comparison the recovery ability of all these solvents and the selectivity towards all these compounds, observing that there are no significant significant differences among them. And we also calculated an average amount of monoesterified astaxanthin and diesterified, observing that also in this case, the data are in line with that found in previous works. Then we studied the lipidic composition of the extract, considering both the fatty acid in minor part bonded to the astaxanthin and the fatty acids that composed the triacylglycerols. And we found that the most part of the fatty acids are oleic acid, linoleic and alpha-linoleic acids, but also stearic acid and palmitic. And also other fatty acids, polyunsaturated fatty acids with 16 carbon atoms. We also made a purification of the extract by flash chromatography in order to better analyze each component of the extract, and obtaining an enriched fraction in monoesterified astaxanthin, we observed that the lipidic composition is similar to the composition of the total fatty acids. As I said before, since the extract cannot be separated from the solvent, it is important to check the ability of the solvent to keep the stability of the extracted compound. Since astaxanthin is known to be a pretty unstable molecule, and we made this analyzing the amount of the astaxanthin after several days from the time zero, which is considered the first time, the first day of extraction, and we observed that tau was the best test. There was the best test to keep astaxanthin stable, giving only a slight decrease in the amount after 79 days. We also tested the antioxidant activity of the mixture DES and extract through DPPH assay, and all the DES demonstrated to keep a good antioxidant activity, but also in this case, tau demonstrated to be the best one, giving a scavenging activity of almost 100%, remaining the best one also after 32 days after the extraction. So we analyzed the antioxidant activity of each component of the extract, considering for one of them the amount effectively present in the extract. And as expected, we observed that thymol alone has a good antioxidant activity, demonstrating that the solvent has a synergistic effect to enhance the antioxidant activity of the extracted astaxanthin. Another interesting application of the protective solvents is the direct extraction directly from the algal culture, avoiding the centrifugation step, but most of all the freeze-drying step, which is considered a very energy-consuming procedure. And also in this case, we observed that there is a good recovery ability towards astaxanthin, observe only a slight decrease respect to the recovery ability using the dried biomass, but observing that also avoiding the energy consuming freeze drying, also this application could be a good possibility. So I'd like to thank the Green Chemistry Lab and the Algal Biology Lab of Ravenna Campus, which contributed to this work. And I thank you for the kind attention.
Thank you, Martina. Please allow me a few seconds just to check if there are any questions, although I expect the answer is no. Is there any question from the members here of the group? Martina, it's an obvious question which normally is asked to academic people, which is not much relevant for an academic environment. But anyway, so I know, understand the limitation of the question. But anyway, you have tested, you have tried to use to run your process at which scale, and at which scale you feel that you may run your process of extraction to be reproducible?
Okay, the amount is here, so we use the 50 milligrams of the freeze-dried biomass using 2 ml of DES, but we observed from recent results that we could decrease the amount of solvent till 1 or less milliliter of DES. And I think that could be interesting also for to increase the scale of the experiments. But for now, this is the maximum amount we used.
Okay. Thank you. So the idea was is that just you can in certain manner intensify the build process.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other question? Well, if not, I want to also thank Martina for this presentation. And again, Chiara and Antonella of the group, all the other members of the groups for helping me in handling the session today. Many thanks to Professor Epping for his contribution to the activity of the group. Certainly there will be more visits to the web page where with Calm people will download and see the video. Thank you and good afternoon to everybody.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone.